Don Love. I have a portrait studio on Tesson Ferry. Like, I purely do not like the lightweight tripods. I call most photographers lazy. I want a tripod that's going to do its job and hold my camera. And not only hold it, but make it stable. So I want it stable. And so mine are normally a little heavy. A couple of words. I said, forget auto. The main thing, if you're shooting on auto, you're not taking any pictures somebody else can't take. You're not doing anything else somebody else can do. So that's not making your particular print special. I look at everything as that print needs to be special, needs to be different than what anybody else is going to be able to do through your own eyes. So if it's going to be different, you need to learn how to control that camera. And auto is not doing it. If you're shooting at 2.8, you're going to have a very shallow depth of field. If you're shooting at f32, you should have a very large depth of field. And f64 has always been considered the perfect f-stop because everything's in focus. That was Kodak's method of making their first water house stop cameras. Everything was in focus. They didn't have to have a focusing mechanism, but they had to have a lot of light. So they told you to shoot out in the sun, keep the sun at your back, and their cameras were perfect. Everything was always in focus. And in critical aperture, most of you probably will not need to know that. And the critical aperture is there is one f-stop that will yield the sharpest focus of all of them, because you are fooling with diffraction. It's different from refraction. Refraction is the junior high experiment where you put a pencil in a glass of water and it looks bent. And that's where light is bending. And diffraction is light being bent going through a small hole. So the smaller the hole, the greater the depth of field, all that. But at the same time, you're going to have some distortion. It won't be as sharp as some of the others. In general, digital cameras like F11.
Is there a reason for that?
That is the compromise between lens aberrations, because the lens itself, when you're shooting at 2.8 wide open, you've got a lot of glass and it's taking in all of that glass, and there's lens aberrations which can cause image distortion, especially around your outside edges. So the more you get rid of that, and the less glass you're using, you're getting rid of those aberrations, lens falls. But the smaller it gets, the more diffraction you get. So F11 is what they're calling the best compromise.
The sweet spot.
The sweet spot.
Okay.
Yes. I was shooting the other day at 1500th of a second. So, wow, that's really fast. 1/1500th of a second. The images you get aren't going, it doesn't show that, it doesn't do anything. And a lot of times, and my best illustration is people photographing cars. If they go to a car race, they want to take pictures of cars, and so the cars are going 200 miles an hour, so you slam up that thing because you're going to freeze that motion. But when you get home and look at your pictures, they just look like a car in a parking lot. It doesn't show that it's going 200 miles an hour. And so how do you get it to show, well, this car is really moving fast, you guys, I froze the motion. But the image doesn't do anything, you can put the stickers on it. The other is panning. So a panning shot is really cool in the fact that you move with the subject at a slow shutter speed. So slow your shutter speed down, move with the subject. It's not easy to do. You can try it a whole bunch of times because it takes a little, because you got to remember to follow through. It's like anything. It's like shooting clay pigeons with a shotgun, sporting events, all those things. You need to follow through.
How do you deal with the blackout? Like, so whenever you click the button, right, the viewfinder goes black. It's the mirror yourself. So if I'm painting, am I making any sense here?
Yes.
So when I'm painting, am I just guessing that I'm moving the same thing, or do I open my other eye? Is there a technique you use for that? Because
I have
right
worried about it. That's just lying. this is one of my panning shots. It keeps going off. I was able to catch a flock of geese taking off in formation close to the water. Normally they don't really form up until they get up in the sky. This one won all kinds of awards last year at the Professional Photographer Association. Because I was shooting at 60th of a second, I was able to really blur the background out. I've got their wingtips blurred, but their heads are all sharp. And that was the key point to the success of the print. The heads and eyes are sharp. And eyes, I want to say eyes, because that's very important in anything you photograph dealing with people as well as animals.
What was your exposure size on that?
It was at a 60th of a second at about 2.8, maybe 5.6. I don't really remember without looking it up.
So you're.
But I did look up the speed that I shot at because everybody was asking me, and I was at a 60th.
So your key there was your panning speed matched the speed of the...
Of the geese.
So that they, the part of them that wasn't moving stayed sharp.
Yes.
So back to my question, is the answer it's all luck? you're moving with them?
You're moving with it. Just continue. You're following through, so it doesn't matter. It's going to black out, who cares? Because you're following through. You just got to keep the motion going. You don't want to hit the shutter, and you don't want to jerk the shutter. You just want to flow with it. Keep your eyes on it as you go and hit the shutter and keep going.
Yeah, blackout's only for a fraction of a second.
Right.
Yeah, but if they're moving 200 miles an hour, that's a long way.
Unless you
stop. Wouldn't
it be better if you continue, so the first, you know, your first touch of the shutter, you just keep going with it? You're bound to get something in that series, or?
First. I have not found the continuous shot thing to do much for me.
Okay.
Wow, I don't know how those guys before you stabilization got anything with those long lenses. It's really hard. I've got a 400mm 2.8, and you just don't slap that thing on and go take pictures with it. It's a little tough, I have found. You really have to concentrate at your shutter release, and you need to, because you don't want to vibrate, you don't want to shake anything, and you want to squeeze. If any of you have ever had any marksmanship training with guns and things, it's squeeze the shutter. Don't jerk it, because you're going to miss. Same thing with photography, it's all the same. You want to squeeze. So as you squeeze, and I have a hard time with that, you get a my fox just does a split second. He was running up a hill away from me. He stopped, turned his head, and looked at me. And I shot, and a split second later, he's going on up the hill. So you just have to anticipate, know what's going to happen, and then shoot. Yes?
One thing I was going to mention, Brian, I had an assignment to do just that day to try and catch some motion, like doing the panning, stopping, and I really had a fun time. I went to a place where cyclists were cycling, and I was waiting for them to come by. Great spot is kind of right over here. There's the kind of a pathway, and it was really great because people were having fun with it because they go by and go like it. So it was great, but just like what you said, you had to know just the right time to do it. Boy, it was a bear. Finally, after a while, you just got this pan.
Seems like practice is the key. I've tried it several times, and usually my subject, I get the blurred, the motion in the background, but usually the subject's blurred as well because I'm not quite at the same speed.
Try the cyclist because they go at various different speeds, and it's good to practice. Just sit there and
But the thing also is, if you're going to do something like a race, like anything that has repetitive, you know, where they're coming back in front of you, just time it. If you're like an oval and they're driving around, they're going to come by at the same speed you know, when they're in the past. So if you do something with their body, okay, it takes me this long to watch them go by this time. You know, they're going to go by it 50 or 60 times at least. So then you start, you know, that then you know next time I just hold my camera and pan with them.
Well, I try to keep the focusing outline, the little dot on the inside. I normally use the center point. And I try to keep that on the same spot on the subject. So you can practice by see if you can keep it on the same spot. It's not easy. It's very hard. And you can call it luck, yes.
So with that one, what was your f-stop? You said 5.6?
I'm not sure about.
So that's pretty thin.
This was sunrise. So, and I was at a 60th. So I must have been, I may have been at 2, I need to look it up.
Are you using 400 on that?
Yeah.
I'd say that's especially, because if they're flying at an angle for you, that's especially impressive to get all the heads in focus, because then they're on different planes, right?
And yes.
Fly across.
Well, that's why I think that I must have been a little more than just 5.6. I must have been about 5, or 2.8. So I must have been 4 to 5.6, I think. But I do know it was sunrise, relatively dim light. I did do, the geese are natural. The background is a little color saturation added. Trying to pull out those colors that were in the background from the sunrise. This just got me all kinds of awards last year. I just got all kinds of stuff. I got a lot of use in motion, but the thing is, the reason they told me that was as they did as well as it did is because I'm actually slightly above geese, and normally if you're photographing geese, you're looking up at them, or you're looking down at them at the water, and here I've got an in-flight, I've actually got trees, not a bald sky, because when they fly in the wintertime, so much of the time it's just a gray sky, and I've got a lot of those, but they're not so good. This one just had a lot more impact because it had the color in with it. So I mean, the color gave me some impact. So that was panning. Most of the time I knew the sun was going down and it's getting low. I hadn't seen a fox, I hadn't seen anything, but and I'm actually walking down the road in the middle of Yellowstone. I don't use the camera light meter. I don't like them. They're too inaccurate. If I get a split second, I don't want the shot to be ruined because the stupid camera put it on the wrong thing. I use a handheld light meter, a reflectance, an incident light meter that's measuring how much light is falling on the subject. I follow that as religiously as I possibly can, and most of the time I've got 95-98% good exposures. And with snow, you need to be perfect. You have to maintain the detail in your whites, and you also have to maintain the detail in your blacks. The Buffalo was 2 years ago, and it won a lot of awards because with digital, it's not very easy to do. I've got bright whites, and I've got black blacks, and I've got detail in everything. And for one, I shoot raw, that helps. So if you're a little off, you can tweak it back a little. If you save, this is one of the big key things for me. If you say, well, I can fix it in Photoshop, you're just asking for a lot of trouble. It's not going to be in the award-winning categories if you're doing that. Because normally, anytime you do something in Photoshop, it's doing something else someplace else. Like if you like that fill light slider, your fill light slider, well, that's giving you more noise and you want to count back in your shadows. So you just have to watch what you do. And I try not to have to fix anything in Photoshop. It just causes more problems somewhere else. So if I nail an exposure, I can tweak it, and the less I have to tweak anything, the better. This one was my 24-105. I had my 400 foot away at that moment, and I had the 24-105 because I thought I was going to be doing a scenic thing. I was walking down this path to go over around some trees. And
key to that is walking down the path.
Yeah.
It means 400 packed.
400 packed. I packed my 400. Try not to go very far. I got a 1 mile loop in one park that up north that I go to sometimes. Man, I've got to stop and rest every now and then. Consider AB and SB or whatever all those are as automatic. You're letting the camera make the exposure decision for you. I will use that on occasion, but not very often. I don't like to get home and find out I haven't got anything. I've tried them and I said, well, why have I got so many bad exposures? TTL is considered one of the best. That just should be the best. I mean, read the thing on it. Man, and for figuring out your exposures, that should be the best system there ever was. The only problem with it is I can't make it work. and the center priority thing for exposure should be perfect, but I still have exposures that aren't right.
I use the center myself, and I look down at the readings, flip it to manual, and start playing with that if I have time. On a fox, you didn't have time.
Right. Well, you don't have time.
Measure off the shadows.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was on the system.
Yeah, exactly.
You don't have time.
No, you don't have time.
And it depends. Your reading, taking them the way you are, if he was lower in the water, I'd have a different reading than if he was higher in the back here, or if he's up in the sky. And those would all be various readings, yet he needs only one exposure.
Correct.
So with my incident light meter, I'm standing on the shoreline, and I'm in the same light as they're going to be. I take my incident light meter reading, and then I'm on. I don't have to worry about a thing. All my exposures are right on the money, and I don't have to worry about going back and saying, well, how many did I screw up because of exposure? I'll have a whole lot screwed up because my trigger finger gets too active and they're blurry. This is a 400, 2.8. Canon's 400. I bought that so that I could, I wanted to do animals. And this elk took hours. I was there for a very long time.
You got him trumpeting.
Yes.
Call it out.
I've got him bugling, and but most, for about 2 hours, I just looked at his posterior. He's just grazing around and grazing around. I said, oh, come on, please do something. I'm in a tree line. And sun's going down, and I was just like, oh, come on, we're losing light. I'm about ready to go in because it's getting down to where I don't have much to shoot. All of a sudden, he just kind of wanders into this ray of light going right through the valley. And I said, yes, yes. And then he started bugling, oh, yes. So I got the shot. But it took hours. I was there for a long time. I froze my brother out. It's 10 degrees or something out. And he's a hunter. He had all his hunting garb on. And he says, I don't know. Your equipment's better than mine. I'm going back to the car. So I stayed, but it worked out. But patience pays and that stuff.
Yeah.
So my zoom, which is the 70 to 200. Canon's top line lens. It's a big dog. Everybody wants one of those things. But my fixed focal length, 400, is sharper. And when I look at I shot the same person because we were just fooling around one day and they had some extra time. And I said, I'd like to try this big lens on you. And they said, sure. So I said, okay. So I did my normal stuff. And I turn around and put on 400. And my camera room's not big enough, but I'm just doing just head. But when I got the images and looked at them, and in my field we like to look at eyelashes to tell if it's in focus. And in my 7200, yeah, I had eyelashes. But when I looked at the 400, I had eyelashes. They had definition. They were defined. And this is out in my backyard. I just did this. Just got this printed. This is for a customer. And this background is just loam. I mean, it's out there. It's grass. It's this grass, actually. And it just blows us. So I call it my painter lens. And I'm using it on my high school seniors. And just now started doing it for my dentist group. I've been doing it for a while. And my N-type close-up glamour type headshots are getting old now. They said, well, can we get something new now? And I said, well, I've been trying to talk you into that, but you wanted the same thing. It's all about the teeth for this purpose of the shot. So now I'm taking them outside and I'm doing this. And everybody's just loving the background and the way it's going. Lots of bokeh. Sometimes I've forgotten my reflector that I put when I turn the flash straight up and I want to bounce a little in. And just a card or a piece of paper, anything, you can just use your hand for that matter too. Hand warms the light up a hint, but it's okay. Since I'm alone, I don't have assistants holding flats, trying to put light into them and all that. That takes a lot of time. I've got a really slick setup on my camera with the Q-flash system. Okay. Somebody told me, well, that's way too expensive. And I said, well, yeah, maybe, but it makes my life so easy. I don't like holding a bracket. Because you're doing this. And to properly hold your camera for the proper mount to do it is elbow in, hold, cradle the lens. This allows you to zoom in and out, whatever you need to do, focus, if you're doing manual. If anybody's doing much of that anymore. The other hand is also in. This gives you a solid base, and especially your stance needs to be stable. And so when you're shooting, in best is kind of turned, and you've got your elbow in, trying to keep it stable so that you can shoot solid. Even with fast shutter speeds, holding it properly and releasing it properly will give you a sharper image than just going to a fast shutter speed. Well, I'll shoot it 500th of a second, it's going to freeze everything until you get down to getting into fine detail. It's still best to hold it. So my bracket that I have is essentially just holds the flash. The worst possible way to take pictures is with people holding out doing the full-time view thing. And you can't hold anything stable. And I said, well, yeah, my images are out of focus. Darn, camera's not working right. It's not the camera at all, too. People don't want to hear that. And the salesman will try not to tell you that, but it is you. Because you can't be stable from here holding it down here. I tried with this silly cell phone. I'm always trying, oh, my God, to hold it. And they're not sharp. I mean, rarely ever. My animals, I need to know what time of day they're the most active, which is normally sunrise and sunset for many. And so you need to know those things before you go. Or you could go out from 9 o'clock to 3 o'clock in the day and not get anything. Well, you're there at the wrong time. Your elk are feeding in the late evening. The most, they're just laying around most of the day. Most of your nature is just laying around through the daytime period when you're the most active. So you've got to get in there. When I'm doing owls, those are early morning or late in the evening. And which is all sweet light, so it's kind of cool. It works out really well. I wanted to mention on their insurance, you need to know that your homeowner's insurance is not going to cover a lot of your camera equipment. They'll cover what they consider basic camera equipment, and if you've got a camera that's, you know, your point and shoots, they'll cover those, but they're not going to cover big lenses and all of that stuff. They put a ceiling on it pretty quick, and they, believe me, they know what things cost. And their ceiling's just under what that lens you just paid for.
Who do you like for insurance? I had State Farm, I had a personal property policy. Once I got a 300, but then once I started earning money with my photography, that's not covered from State Farm anymore.
Right.
So I'm in the process of getting a new policy. Who do you like?
Philadelphia and Travelers. Okay. All of our equipment's through Travelers, and all of our liability and business owner policies through Philadelphia.
Mine's all inclusive. I went with Columbia. And it covers everything, including personal injury if a light would fall over on a kid or something like that.
Right.
And it covers all the equipment I have, and that's through Columbia. It's a Missouri-based company.
It's very interesting how the company responded, and they say do not add it on to your homeowners, because if you have an issue and your equipment gets stolen, that somewhere in the future they will deny you homeowner coverage as well. Yeah. And it was interesting because I said to the company, is that true? She said, yeah, you might want to look into that a little bit further. And she said, I would suggest not doing that.
Right.
And that was how she left it.
Okay.
So I think, was there some kind of marine something or other?
Yeah, there's the marine policy, which is kind of the umbrella thing that they'll add on and stick it onto the cover. At your boats and RVs and stuff.
If you're not making money with this stuff, your homeowners can just schedule it just as you would jewelry.
Right.
I mean, yeah, that makes perfect sense. If you're not doing it for profit, if you're doing it for personal enjoyment, put it on your homeowners.
Well,
as a
friend of mine has a studio, got audited, they told her she can't do that, and yet, but it's been a standard in the industry. Where did the change come from? And we found out it was just that auditor. And we're still doing everything the same. So there's gray areas, and the gray areas are real funny. Try not to get away with anything. Plant safe.